If you watch a chimpanzee walk upright, you can see that it keeps its legs far apart and its upper body sways from side to side. In contrast, we Homo sapiens sway our torsos almost imperceptibly, which means our energy expenditure is mostly directed to moving forward instead of stabilizing the upper body. Our steadier gait is largely attributable to a simple change in the shape of our pelvis. As the figure shows, the large, broad bone that forms the upper part of the pelvis, the ilium, is tall and faces backwards in apes. But this part of the hip is short and faces sideways in humans. This sideways orientation is a crucial adaptation for bipedalism because it allows the muscles on the side of the hips to stabilize the upper body over each leg during walking. Another important adaptation for being a biped is an S-shaped spine. Like other quadrupeds, apes have spines that curve gently, so when they stand upright, their trunks naturally tilt forward. Their torso is positioned in front of its hips. This means they have to contract lots of muscles in their posterior chain, their extrinsic and intrinsic back musculature, and their gluteal muscles to stop from falling forward. In contrast, our spine has two pairs of curves, which center around our thoracic kyphosis and a lumbar lordosis. This brings our center of mass back over our bipedal base of support, so we can stand with much less effort. That's not all either. We have expanded heel bones that increase the leverage of the muscles and tendons around our legs and feet, arches in our feet to store energy, a big toe that points forward, allowing us to push off, stabilized ankles, long legs for efficiency, buttressed knees to absorb force, inwardly angled thighs, expanded hip joints, and a downwardly oriented foramen magnum, the hole at the base of the skull where the spinal cord exits the cranial cavity. The consequence of all these adaptations is a more efficient gait. Experiments conducted in the early 70s that involved getting chimpanzees to walk on a treadmill while wearing oxygen masks showed that walking was almost three times more costly in chimpanzees than in humans and other mammals of the same size. Early hominins were walking about 6 million years ago, but they needed an additional 4 million years to acquire the capabilities for endurance running. Taking the Neanderthals as an example, they were probably more efficient walkers than us due to their wider waists, their massively muscled thighs, their slightly curved leg bones, and reinforced foot arches. These adaptations were needed to cope with their greater bulk, but they also meant that sprinting, and especially endurance running, would have been more difficult for them.
So what anatomical adaptations have enabled us to be so good at endurance running?
First, our legs are relatively long for an animal of our size, something that becomes obvious when standing next to a chimpanzee. Human legs also have lengthy elastic tendons like the Achilles. Longer tendons like the Achilles aren't necessary for walking, but they function as springs during running. Every time your legs and feet land on the ground during a run, these tendons stretch as your hips, knees, and ankles flex and the arch in your foot flattens. When the tendons recoil, the energy they store is returned to help propel you back into the air. We can also rotate our trunks as we pump our arms in a kind of counter-synchrony with our legs, which helps to conserve energy. And then we have the nuchal ligament at the base of the skull, which helps keep our heads steady as we run. When it comes to our cardiovascular system, at rest, the heart pumps about 4 to 6 litres of blood each minute, but during running, it can pump as much as 5 times more to supply hard-working muscles and cool the body. A typical runner's heart pumps 20 to 24 litres a minute, and an elite runner's can reach an impressive 35 litres a minute. We also have an increased blood supply to the brain to help cool this vital organ during exercise. Our leg muscles usually have 50 to 70% fatigue-resistant, slow-twitch fibres, far more than chimpanzees, which range from 11 to 32%. We humans have evolved an effective cooling system by taking advantage of special water-secreting eccrine glands. We alone have 5 to 10 million sweat glands all over our skin, especially in our heads, limbs, and chests. Sweating effectively turns the entire body into a giant wet tongue. We also lost our fur, which helps air move along the skin's surface without any barrier, and this enables us to rapidly discharge large quantities of heat.